This program was made possible by a grant from the National Endowment for the Humanities.
January 26th, 1870, Fort Russell, Wyoming Territory. Dear Brother Michael, I received your welcome letter this afternoon. I was very glad to hear that you and all the family in Cratlow were well. Michael, I'm in first-rate health. I was never better in my life. This Rocky Mountain air agrees with me first-rate. I have everything that would tend to make life comfortable. But still, at night, when I lay in bed, my mind wanders off across the continent and over the Atlantic to the hills of Cratlow. In spite of all, I can never forget home, as every Irishman in a foreign land can never forget the land he was raised in. Every stone, gap, and field in Cratlow and its surroundings are as clear in my mind as when I was home. I sometimes imagine I am on top of Bala, near Daniel Reardon's, looking over upon Cratlow and upon the old lime kiln where I used to play ball in my youth. But alas, I am far away from them old haunts. But still, I imagine that I will see Cratlow once more. But if I do, I guess all things will be changed. I must close and remain as ever your devoted brother, Morris H. Wolf. Write soon.
Maurice Wolf was one of the 7 million men and women who came out of Ireland to America in the 18th, 19th, and 20th centuries. The Irish immigrants, whose lives transformed and were transformed by the histories of two nations. They would make for themselves a life in America, but their story truly begins in Ireland.
Memories of thinking about America at all was when my grandmother used to take me to the beach in Ballybunion in County Kerry, and we sit on the beach looking at the waves as the tide was coming in, and she'd tell me about the white horses, and she'd say they were on the way out to Hay Brazel, the Isle of the Blessed, out beyond the Western Ocean, and that way beyond that again was Tiernanogue, the land of eternal youth. And way beyond that again was America, where all the people from Gnieguilla were all out there working and getting on in life. And I remember that was my very first notion of America. I must have been about 6 or 7 at the time. And it was always a strange place out there where there were lots of Kerry people.
Immigration in Ireland is a predominant way of life. It has been going on since the Milesians landed in South Kerry over 2,000 years ago, and I suspect it will go on forever.
Throughout the 18th century, large numbers of Irish emigrants from Ulster, the northern province of Ireland, came looking for land on the frontier of colonial America. Most of them were Presbyterians of Scotch ancestry, with names like Jackson and Buchanan, Robinson and Crockett. But with the coming of the 19th century, the Scots-Irish were joined by a new stream of emigrants from all four provinces. These emigrants would have distinctly different reasons for leaving Ireland and distinctly different experiences in America, in large part because they were Catholic. Take, for example, The experiences of two brothers named Devereux. Devereux was an Irish Norman name and was pronounced Devereux by their neighbors in a small county Wexford crossroads called the Lepp. John and Walter Devereux were both destined to emigrate from Ireland, but under considerably different circumstances. This is an etching of John Devereux. No image of Walter Devereux remains, but we know that he was the older and the more impulsive of the two. In the 1790s, John and Walter lived with their father, mother, and three younger brothers just southwest of the River Slaney. The Devereux were fairly comfortable farmers, but they were bitterly resentful. As Irish Catholics, the land once owned by their ancestors had been taken away. For 500 years, English armies had repeatedly invaded Ireland. In 1690, the conquest was sealed by the victory of William of Orange over the Irish Catholic armies at the Battle of the Boyne. The conquerors imposed harsh penal laws denying Catholics basic civil rights, such as the right to vote or to hold office, and forced them to practice their religion in secret. Most important, the Crown colonized Ireland by confiscating nearly all Catholic lands and ceding them to English Protestant landlords, who built imposing gentry houses on large estates, often covering thousands of acres. About 3 miles from the Devereux homestead stood Wilton Castle. From here, the Protestant Alcock family presided over land confiscated by the British from the Catholic families who had owned it for centuries. Families like the Devereux, who now had to pay rent for what used to be their own land.
Well, for the vast majority of the Irish people, until very recently, land was the only means of subsistence, the only means of employment, the only means of potential profit. And those who could profit most were, of course, those who owned the land. So depriving the overwhelming majority of the Catholics of ownership of the land put them in an extraordinarily difficult and inferior economic position.
You were not permitted to take a game on the landlord's land. You were not allowed to pick mushrooms on the landlord's land. You were not allowed to pick up twigs for kindling on the landlord's land. You had to support a church that was not your own. You had an overbearing power, an army of occupation, a vigilant police force, a landlord class that was also a government class. So the landlord and the government looked right at you all the time.
In 1796, John Devereux packed up his frustrations and emigrated to America, hoping to make his living as a dancing teacher. But his brother Walter chose a radically different course. Across the road from the Devereux house at the Lepp was the forge of a blacksmith. Walter suggested to his neighbor that there might be a market for more than horseshoes among thousands of County Wexford farmers who were turning their attention towards the violent overthrow of their British landlords. The blacksmith went to work, making long steel pikes to be used as weapons by the insurgents, organizing under the green banner of the United Irishmen. Inspired by the French and the American revolutions, and including both Catholics and Protestants, they rapidly grew in strength and numbers. The British Army and local Protestant loyalists retaliated with a campaign of cruel repression. But such persecution only inflamed the spirits of Walter Devereux and the United Irishmen, who quickly came to be known as the Pikemen.
April the 1st, 1798. Dear brother, it is the greatest happiness to you that you left this unfortunate country, now the prey of the Orange and Castle bloodhounds. Almost every county in poor old Ireland under martial law, and the poor country peasants shot or hanged or bastilled without law or form of trial. Thank God that Irish men have resolution and can suffer more and will be free. If the times are not settled before next August, I certainly will then leave this land of tyranny and seek a land of liberty. But for a man here to promise himself a single day to live would be presumption. For nothing but God and the majesty of the people can save us from what every Irishman must and will shortly endeavor to crush to the earth. Your ever-loving brother, Walter C. Devers.
1 month later, the rebellion of 1798 began. Led by a Catholic priest, Walter and his pikemen attacked, at first with stunning success.
Pikemen to your knees!
But in June, the United Irishmen met the British Army in a climactic battle at a place called Vinegar Hill. Just 4 miles from the Devereux farm, at the foot of a stone windmill, the pikemen were defeated. Defeated, too, were the Devereux family dreams of regaining the land they felt was theirs. In the following years, Walter's three younger brothers emigrated, joining John in America. With the money earned from his dancing lessons, John had purchased a small general store in Utica, New York, population 200. With the completion of the Erie Canal in 1825, dug largely by Irish laborers, the little town began to grow, and the Devereux brothers began to profit. By mid-century, John Devereux was mayor of Utica, and the family had transformed the general store into a sprawling financial empire of banking, warehousing, merchandising, and land speculation. But what of the radical brother Walter? In the wake of the rebellion, Walter was a marked man trying to avoid capture by the British Army. He fled Ireland, sailing to the island of Martinique in the West Indies, and was never heard from again.
Dear brother, is it the greatest happiness to you that you left this unfortunate country, now the prey of the Orange and the Castle Bloodhounds? Almost every county in poor old Ireland under martial law and the poor country peasants shot or hanged or Bastille without law or form of trial. I like Bastille because they were inheriting the French symptoms there, you see. But for a man here to promise himself a single day to live would be presumption. For nothing but God and the majesty of the people can save us from what every Irishman must and will shortly endeavour to crush to the earth. That's terrible sad. I'm reminded of the song Napatendi. Oh, I met with Napatendi, and he took me by the hand. And he said, how's poor old Ireland, and how does she stand? She's the most distressful country that ever yet was seen. For they're hanging men and women for the wearing of the green.
Well, most nationalists explained emigration as exile. They argued that emigration would have been unnecessary had it not been for the British conquest, colonization. And so all subsequent Irish Catholic emigrants were regarded, on a rhetorical level at least, as being exiles. The Irish language did not have a word which approximates the English word emigrant with its voluntary, neutral connotations. The word which Irish speakers almost invariably used was jury, which literally meant exile, one who had been banished. And so it had all these negative and sorrowful and tragic connotations.
Well, now that I'm titled a United Man, no more can I stay in my own native land. Oh, the sails, they're all set, and the wind, it blows fair. Oh, he's gone, God be with him, he's the rambler from Clare. And I always thought that was, there was something very lonesome about that, the fact that he would say he's gone, God be with him, the kind of finality of that. The idea that exile was basically the only option because of political persecution.
In the mid-19th century, most of the population of Ireland lived in small settlements such as the one called Ardnaglass, in the western part of County Sligo. In 1825, the family of Thomas and Bridget Barrett emigrated from Sligo, crossing the Atlantic to an Irish Catholic settlement in the province of Quebec, Canada. But the Barretts left behind their older daughter Mary, who married a man named Michael Rush and started her own family. Ardnaglass was little more than a crowded cluster of one or two room cottages, with roofs made of thatch and walls of mud or mortarless stone, surrounded by yards where pigs rooted and stunted cattle grazed among the rocks. Each family had a tiny garden growing potatoes, virtually the only food crop available to Irish peasants. Our image of Ireland today may be of a sparsely populated pastoral country, but the Ireland that Mary Rush knew was densely populated, almost double what it is today. Despite intense poverty, potatoes had kept Mary Rush and her family relatively well fed. But their sole dependence on that crop was about to have disastrous consequences. An elderly farmer described the strange events of autumn 1845.
A mist rose up out of the sea, and you could hear a voice talking near a mile off across the stillness of the earth. It was the same for 3 days or more, and then when the fog lifted, you could begin to see the tops of the potato stalks lying over as if the life was gone out of them. And that was the beginning of the great trouble and famine that destroyed Ireland.
A vicious blight surged through the potato crop, creating a famine of horrific proportions. The British government made some efforts at relief, but the tragic irony was that during the years of the famine, large amounts of food were being shipped out of Ireland to Britain. Between 1846 and 1851, over 1 million people died of starvation and disease. Yet another tragedy of the famine years was also the direct result of British policy. If a tenant fell behind in his rent, or if a landlord simply wished to clear his land for grazing, the landlord could call upon the forces of the British Crown. Local officials would physically remove the Irish family from their home.
Leave them alone! We don't want you here!
This policy was enforced throughout the 19th century, but during the years of the famine alone, over 500,000 Irish people were evicted from their homes. The hardships of the famine fell most heavily on the west of Ireland. For many of the Catholic peasants in places like Ardnaglass, the only option was emigration. But Michael and Mary Rush had no money to pay their passage out of Ireland. They felt that there was only one place to turn for help.
September the 6th, 1846, County Sligo, Ireland. To Thomas Barrett, Ottawa River, Canada. Dear father and mother, pen cannot dictate the poverty of this country at present. The potato crop is quite done away all over Ireland, and there is nothing expected here, only an immediate famine. If you knew what danger We and our fellow countrymen are suffering. If you were ever so much distressed, you would take us out of this poverty, Ide. We can only say that the scourge of God fell down on Ireland in taking away the potatoes, they being the only support of the people. So, dear father and mother, if you don't endeavor to take us out of it, it will be the first news you will hear by some friend of me and my little family to be lost by the hunger. And there are thousands dread that they will share the same fate. Michael and Mary Rush. For God's sake, take us out of the poverty. And don't let us die with the hunger.
In his impoverished Canadian community, Thomas Barrett received his daughter's letter, but had no money to pay for her passage. In desperation, he turned to his parish priest. They petitioned the British government, asking that relief funds be used to bring famine victims to North America. But Sir Charles Trevelyan, the director of relief efforts, felt such expenditures unjustified.
The great evil with which we have to contend is not the physical evil of the famine, but the moral evil of the selfish, perverse, and turbulent character of the Irish people.
Those English attitudes were a major impediment to the English government giving the Irish people adequate relief during the famine. And they were more concerned that too much charity might destroy Irish character, which English politicians never had a high opinion of anyway, than that famine might kill them. Just as a colonized people have a strong tendency to envy and to emulate those who appear superior because they are stronger and wealthier, so also the colonizers tend to justify their rule by force by arguing that the people over whom they rule are in every way inferior to them and therefore have to be taken care of as if they were disobedient children.
It is difficult to know whether Mary Rush and her family were able to escape the famine. They may have died in Ireland, victims of hunger or disease. Over the course of the famine, the population of their parish fell by more than one-third. But many of those who died were buried in unmarked graves. Another possibility is that Mary Rush and her family left Ireland, but never arrived in America. Typhus and dysentery killed 50,000 Irish men, women, and children in the quarantine camps of America and aboard the emigrant vessels known as the coffin ships.
We don't know for sure whether they did escape. You know, it's a great unknown. But one thing for certain, they never showed up in Canada.
Son, I loved my native land with energy and pride. Until a blight came on the crops, the sheep and the cattle died. The rent and taxes were to pay, I could not them redeem. And that's the cruel reason why I left all Skibbereen.
Between 1845 and 1860, a period of only 15 years, the population of Ireland was reduced by one-third. Over 1 million people died, and over 2 million people emigrated, swelling the stream of Irish Catholic immigrants to America into a flood.
Dear mother and brothers, we mean to let you know our situation at present. We arrived here about 5 o'clock in the afternoon of yesterday, 14 of us together, where we were received with the greatest kindness and respectability by Matthew Leary and Dennis Danahy. When we came to the house, we could not state to you how we were treated. We had potatoes, meat, butter, bread and tea for dinner, and you may be sure we had a drink after in Matthew Leary's house. They went to the store and bought 2 dozen bottles of small beer and a gallon of gin, otherwise whiskey, so that we were drinking until morning. Dear friends, if you were to see old Dennis Danahy, he never was as good health and looks better than ever he did at home. And you may be sure he can have plenty of tobacco, and he told me to mention it to Tim Murphy. As to the girls that used to be trotting the bogs at home, to hear them talk English would be of great astonishment to you. Mary Keefe got 2 dresses, one from Mary Danahy and the other from Biddy Matt.
Oh, such finery. Kid Mila Fonte.
One letter will do for us all. Daniel Guiney.
You're as welcome as the flowers in May.
Some Irish immigrants arrived imagining that the streets of America were paved with gold. Here, at least, there were jobs.
They go across the prairies with the expanding lines of the railroads. They struggled in the textile factories of the industrial city of Philadelphia. They competed with slaves for jobs on the docks of New Orleans. And they even went to San Francisco, where by 1860 there were 20,000 Irish-born people, a result of the gold rush. They wander with cattle herds after the American Civil War. They're part of the migrant lumber population in the Northwest. They're on American warships and merchant ships all over the world. The men who did the high iron work, bridge building and building the steel skeletons for skyscrapers, they flooded into all kinds of places.
Sister, I know today you are all, or at least a good part of you, in Dunamana Fair. I'm just thinking as I sit here alone of the times I used to have on these occasions. There are no Dunamana Fairs here. There's nothing here but work hard today and go to bed at night. And rise and work harder tomorrow. Nothing but work. Work away. John wants to know if I've played the fiddle any now. But you may tell him that if he was here to put on mortar for 1 week, he'd have very little notion about fiddling on Saturday nights. I sometimes think, when I go to my room without anyone to speak to me, of the nights when we used to sit down by the fire and draw down our old fiddles. Meditations are not very pleasant. However, people need not expect a great deal of enjoyment when they come here. Give all my love to my old neighbours and friends. You'll scarce be able to make this out. I was just beginning to think that I had the trowel in my hand. Farewell all. D. McIntyre. Write soon.
McIntyre, I think, might have been one of those immigrants who discovered to his sorrow that the streets of America were not paved with gold, but rather that the Irish immigrants were expected to pave the streets themselves and to do so at very low wages.
When the diggers of canals wanted to get a labor force in building the Chesapeake Canal in Virginia, they went to the plantation owners and said, "Rent us your slaves." The plantation owners said, "No way. These slaves are worth money. Get Irishmen. If they die, there's no monetary loss." These were people who got up every morning and went to very, very laborious tasks. Whether they were women servants or whether they were men who worked in steel mills, these were men who were subject to the most fierce exploitation at a time when capitalism had no governors and had no constraints upon it in the mid-19th century.
Thank you.
give my love to all my old neighbours and friends. You will scarce be able to make this out. I was just beginning to think that I had the towel in my hand. Farewell. That's so true. Big change from the fiddle to the towel. You see, the hands, the soft hands that made fiddle music in Ireland were now calloused, you know. Unredeemable hands that might never play the fiddle again.
In the northern province of Ulster, in County Antrim, about 15 miles from the city of Belfast, was the small hamlet of Rory's Glen. In the 1850s, the consequences of the Great Famine forced a boy named William Murphy and his family to leave Rory's Glen. Rural Ireland was full of men like his father, a laborer too poor to rent, much less purchase, a farm of his own. In Belfast, Ireland's only industrial city of the 19th century, the Murphys sought employment in the linen mills and in the shipyards. But they failed to find work there, and the family was forced to settle in a slum crowded with refugees of the famine. There, both of William's parents and three of his siblings shortly died, probably of disease and malnutrition. Of the survivors, a sister and a brother chose to remain in Ireland. But in 1862, William and his two other brothers, James and Robert, chose to emigrate. William Murphy came to America looking for a job, and he found it in the United States Navy during the American Civil War. He was one of over 150,000 men born in Ireland who were asked to fight and die for a cause and a nation they barely knew. Nevertheless, they served proudly, many in all Irish Catholic regiments, such as New York's Fighting 69th. After 2 years of military service, William Murphy went to work as a laborer in Erie, Pennsylvania in 1865, and in Pittsburgh in 1866, and in Chicago in 1867. He went to New York in 1869, and then shipped out to Florida. In 1870, he finally settled down with one job, building railroad bridges, everywhere from Virginia to faraway California.
Dear brother and sister, I have to knock around so much of the work I follow that I'm hardly ever more than a week or two in one place. And I make up my mind to write every place I go. But when I get there, I think this way. Well, I'm not going to be long here. Perhaps the next place I go, I can wait and get an answer. And so it goes. But I hope you will forgive me. I assure you, I never for a moment forget you. No doubt you think, why don't I settle down like other people? I've asked myself that question 1,000 times. I have gone further. I have tried to do so. But when I try it, I soon get tired. And the restless spirit gets the best of me all the time. The fact is, traveling is so natural to me that, sure, I might as well try to live without eating as without wandering around. But what difference does it make? Life is but a dream. And although I know that my last days will be spent in all probability among strangers, I almost wish sometimes the dream is over. Don't think for a moment that I'm despondent or downhearted, for I am anything but that. But just think for a second of the past that is gone, never to be recalled. It seems but yesterday since we were a happy and united family. Mother, father, brothers and sisters. Where are they now? They grew together side by side. They filled one hall with glee. Their graves are scattered far and wide by mountain, stream, and sea. James, the latest of our loved and lost, laid him down to rest in the faraway California. He, like thousands more, tried to find a fortune, and instead he found a grave. Where could he find a more fitting resting place than in Lone Mountain, The last rays of the setting sun kiss his grave as it sinks behind the waters of the great Pacific. And his spirit has crossed the great divide and joined the others in that better land beyond. Dear brother and sister, may God bless and preserve you. It is the earnest prayer of your affectionate brother, William.
The further afield that I travel, like the more out on the fringes, the further away from Ireland that I go and find Irish people, it's out there that I find the most restless ones. The ones who will basically, you know, if there were another universe, you'd find them out there looking for something or escaping from something. And I think it's they're part of the kind of romantic vision of the Irishman, the lone frontiers person. The cowboy who in the popular movies rides off into the sunset, you know, as the credits come down. They're the William Murphys of the world.
Yeah, well, it's the traditional American dream, isn't it, as well as the Irish dream, that you go ever, ever westward in pursuit of your fortune. And eventually you come to California, and that's the end. You can't go any further. But of course, it's also ironic because both in Irish and in other cultures, the notion of going west also means to die.
And I remember the first time I saw the Pacific. That was the first thing I thought of was how far away from Ireland I was. As I stood looking at the Pacific, I had a whole different attitude to looking at the Pacific than looking at the Atlantic. And I remember I took off my shoes, I was on the coast of California, and I walked out, and I'll never forget when my toe touched the Pacific, and all I could think of was how far away from Ireland it was as I put my foot in the water.
Shanties with a fierce wind howling through them, a scene of suffering presented itself which made the heart sick. All along for miles was one continued scene of anguish and suffering, as if some peculiar curse was chasing the unfortunate people of Ireland. It is a well-established fact that the average length of life of the immigrant after landing here is 6 years. And many insist it is much less. Patrick Walsh.
Because of their poverty and their Catholicism, the Irish were often depicted in the American press as violent and less than human. Discrimination against the Irish ranged from job notices with the warning that no Irish need apply, to the formation of political movements, such as the Know Nothing Party, which was determined to stop the flow of Irish immigrants into America.
The influx of the Irish provided America with the first mass demonstration of cultural rights and liberties that had been guaranteed in the Constitution but never really tested. Religious liberty, the right of freedom of association, the right to send your children to a school of your own choice. These things had to be worked out in American society.
The Irish were the first group that were really poor, and therefore American society had to learn to deal with this kind of difference. The fact is that they were the first Catholic group, and America had a very long tradition of anti-Catholicism. The Irish were, by the way, perceived to be a separate race. And that is, it wasn't just that they were kind from the British Isles, but were Catholic. They were perceived to be of an utterly different race. If you asked a 19th century, an early or mid-19th century American, if they could tell who was Irish, they would say absolutely. That is, that they had physical characteristics that it was believed set them off from others. And therefore, the reaction was a racial one, as well as a religious one, as well as a cultural one, as well as an economic one.
Dear Catherine, affairs are becoming fearful in this country.
The Know-Nothings have murdered a number of Irishmen in Louisville and destroyed their property. I hope the prospects in Ireland are good this year. If people can live comfortable there, they ought to remain there. James Dixon.
The largest city in Ireland is Dublin, situated on the east coast just across the Irish Sea from England. Living in Dublin in the 1840s was a politically ambitious young man named Richard O'Gorman. The son of a wealthy merchant, he attended the prestigious Trinity College, but Trinity was Protestant, and Richard O'Gorman was Catholic. When the school required him to take a graduation oath that was repugnant to his faith, he refused. Instead, O'Gorman joined a radical nationalist organization called the Young Irelanders. In 1848, in the depths of the Great Famine, the Young Irelanders raised an armed rebellion against the British, but their efforts came to an abrupt end in a County Tipperary cabbage patch. As revolution, Young Ireland's effort was a farce, but as revolutionary theater, it was a grand gesture that politicized the sufferings of the famine, evictions, and emigration. In the wake of the skirmish, Richard O'Gorman escaped aboard a fishing boat. It was not Dublin that held O'Gorman's political future, but New York City.
Dear friend, New York is the headquarters of political corruption. It is here organized a sort of university for educating the rising generation in the endless variety of means of cheating the public out of their votes. A few leaders choose candidates, bring up their army of voters, and the thing is somehow done as they command. There have been various most energetic efforts at reform made during my time. The results were funny. Great struggle, infinite speech making, denunciation, detection, and great victory. Virtue triumphant at last, new men ruleless. And when we come to look at the bills for the year, we're robbed and cheated and taxed worse than before. I'm told that this is the boiling and effervescing of the vat. The wine will come in time. I hope so. For the present, however, the thing is neither pleasant nor good. It's refreshing, however, to find that in this effervescent process, our countrymen have their share. In all political proceedings, smashing ballot boxes, personating citizens, filling minor offices of all kinds, and plundering the public for the public good, in readiness to gull others or be gulled themselves, the children of our native land are eminently successful. I am yours faithfully, Richard O'Gorman.
It was corrupt. Voting was physical combat. It was who controlled the polls physically, who controlled the voting pattern. Political disputes were often solved in brawls, eye-gouging, ear-biting brawls. And that rough-and-tumble style of American politics gave the Irish the opportunity to become part of the political system.
Perhaps their long struggle against persecution had forced Irish Catholics to become expert political organizers. But another reason for their success in American urban politics was simple arithmetic. By 1870, one of every five voters in New York City had been born in Ireland.
By the end of the 19th century, the early 20th century, the Irish were a political force to be reckoned with. Those Irish immigrants who were able to tie themselves into the network of political and economic patronage which those machines were able to provide were either able to do very well, or at least they were able to utilize the political machine to give them more security than they might otherwise have experienced. One can't blame them. Yankee American society was highly prejudicial towards the Irish because of their ethnicity, because of their religion. So it's no wonder that when the Irish had an opportunity to gain political power and economic security, they took it, even though perhaps the means they chose was somewhat less savory than one might have hoped.
In 1870, the New York Times accused the city government of corruption, singling out city attorney Richard O'Gorman for bribery and fraud. Abandoning the ideals of his youth, O'Gorman had used his reputation as an exiled patriot to mobilize New York's Irish voters behind the Democratic Party of city boss Bill Tweed. Tweed's Tammany Hall political machine, which was corrupt well before the famine Irish came to New York, rewarded O'Gorman with money and power. By the 1880s, O'Gorman was a judge on the New York Superior Court, living in uptown Manhattan with his wife and five children, and spending his summers at the beach on Long Island. And when he died in 1894, even the Times hailed Richard O'Gorman as a leader of his people and a fine American. Perhaps it was inevitable that he had left his youthful idealism behind in Dublin, where being a Catholic made it impossible to obtain the kind of real political power he had won in New York.
There was this great political boss of the late 19th century, George Washington Plunkett, who said, he wanted on his tombstone, "I seen my opportunities and I took them." We could describe this about the Irish vis-a-vis American politics. That is, they came in at a time when politics was expanding, with the meaning of government was expanding, and when, in fact, by the way, the sort of native-born Yankee class came to disdain politics. And they plunged into that vacuum and they used it for their advantage. I can tell you that historians and political scientists are still trying to figure out why and how the Irish came to dominate American urban politics, despite the fact that they had been such outsiders and such a rejected group in society.
Few 19th century Irish American Catholics achieved Richard O'Gorman's political and financial success. Most of them faced grinding poverty and relentless discrimination. But if those problems frustrated them as individuals, they also galvanized the Irish as a group.
That group had to help itself. It had to rely on itself. There was no American government. There was no welfare state, no social security. This group had to establish its own institutions. That meant schools, hospitals, orphanages, charitable organizations, labor organizations, trade unions, all kinds of professional groups, political agitation against child labor, against the exploitation of women. All kinds of institutions that we now take for granted. So the achievement of the Irish Americans was not only one of survival, but also one of positive development.
Perhaps the ability of the Irish to survive in America can best be explained by their reaction to the cruel slogan, "No Irish Need Apply." They set it to music and made it one of the most popular songs of the 1870s.
"I am a decent Irishman, and I come from Ballyfad, and I want a situation, and I want it mighty bad. A position I saw advertised is a thing for me, says I, but the dirty spalpeen ended with, 'No Irish need apply.' Well, says I, but that's an insult, but to get this place I'll try. So I went to see the blackguard with, 'No Irish need apply.' Well, some may think it a misfortune to be christened Pat or Dan, but to me it is an honor to be born an Irish man." Well, in the song, he goes on to beat the living daylights out of the fellow and to extract a promise from him never again to put up a sign that says, "No Irish need apply."
"My dear father and mother, I remit to you in this letter $20. That is £4. Thinking it might be some acquisition to you until you might be clearing away from that place altogether. And the sooner the better. For believe me, I could not express how great would be my joy at our seeing you all here together, where you will never want or be at a loss for a good breakfast and dinner. Your ever dear and loving child, Margaret McCarthy.
Those families put together, according to Arnold Schreier's calculation, more than $260 million. The greatest transatlantic philanthropy of the 19th century.
It could be used to pay rents. It could be used to enlarge farms. It could be used to convert an old thatched cottage into a new slate-roofed house with a respectable parlor in which the priest could be entertained. It could mean the difference between poverty and economic security. Irish immigrants were discouraged from sending what were known as empty letters home. The father of some immigrants who lived in Roscommon was alleged to say, after having received photographs from his children in America, "Ah, why did they bother sending these? We know damn well what they look like. The pictures I want to see are some of Abraham Lincoln's on $5 bills." You have to remember that the overwhelming majority of the money was used to finance more immigration. The chain migration was dependent upon money and passage tickets sent by the Irish in America to the Irish at home. It was therefore easy then for immigration to take such a strong and permanent hold upon the Irish people. As one peasant from West Kerry put it, if he didn't emigrate to America by the early 20th century, he would never see most of his relatives again.
On New Year's Day of 1892, the first boatload of immigrants approached America's new facility at Ellis Island. The first person down the gangplank was an Austrian man, but he politely stepped back in deference to a 15-year-old Irish girl named Annie Moore, making her the first immigrant to enter America through Ellis Island. It was a fitting turn of events, for although there had been other early groups, it was the Irish who had set the terms of the relationship between American society and the waves of immigrants from many other nations to come.
No experience has touched so many Americans in its implications as this great historic drama of emigration. We're coming to a new age in America when people are coming to this nation from Asia and Latin America in very great numbers. For the first time, really, America is not sure what it thinks and feels about these new immigrants. For us to understand their predicament, their problems in this fast-paced society, it's necessary for us to study the immigration of the past.
If we can come to an understanding of one group that was compelled to leave its homeland, to transplant itself someplace new, pick and choose among the options the new world had to offer them, pick and choose among the sort of baggage they brought, and create a new culture, which is in a sense a new response to a new environment, we have gone a long way not only towards understanding American society, but towards understanding a very fundamental human experience.
My dear friend, the destiny of our race is to me utterly mysterious. For so much mental and physical vigor, elasticity and adaptability must have a destiny to fulfill. There seems to me nothing in the Irish nature to indicate a worn out, a moribund race. The moment it touches this soil, it seems to be imbued with miraculous energy for good and evil. So that something Irish is prominent everywhere, and you have to praise or blame to bless or curse it at every turn. My own belief is that this northern continent will fall into the hands of men whose composition will be four-fifths Celtic. The descendants of the Puritans, the Saxon element, is physically deteriorating and will soon have done its work. A softer, more genial generation of men will be needed. More capable of enjoyment, more artistic than the Yankee. And our Celtic blood will just supply the want. I'm your faithful friend, Richard O'Gorman,
Over the decades of the 19th century, the Irish people had struggled against grinding poverty, landlord oppression, and the horrors of the Great Famine. In response, they created a transatlantic solution, money from America flowing east and the emigrants from Ireland flowing west. In the America of the late 19th century, the refugees of the Great Famine had died. In the future, Irish America would be populated by their children and their grandchildren, and by new streams of immigrants from Ireland, for whom America represented not so much a refuge from disaster as a promise of fulfillment. The parish of Dunamagan lies on a broad plain of fertile land in the western part of County Kilkenny and is one of the richer farming areas in Ireland. In the 1880s, it was home to Mary Ann Rowe, a woman in her late 20s with the dark brown hair and pale blue eyes of her Norman Irish ancestors. Mary Ann lived here on this farm with her parents and younger sister. Although the Rowes were Catholics and did not own their own land, they farmed over 70 acres and were relatively comfortable. But in 1888, Mary Ann Rowe made plans to leave her apparently idyllic life in Dunamagan and emigrate to America. She was not alone in her decision. Of all the immigrant groups coming to America in the late 19th century, the Irish were one of the only ones in which women outnumbered men. For hundreds of years, elderly Irish farmers had broken up their farms and given a plot to each son. It meant a ready supply of young men with their own land for women to marry. Wives often earned much of the family income from cottage industries, and they worked side by side with their husbands on the farm. But in the years after the famine, the forces of change in the modern world finally reached Ireland. British factory-made goods flowed into Ireland, making women's cottage industries obsolete. And British demand for Irish cattle obliged farmers to keep their herds as large as possible. Instead of dividing up their land, farmers willed it intact to only one son. The other sons often stayed to work on their brother's farm. But for the daughters, it meant that there was neither work nor a supply of marriageable young men with land. The Rowe family had no sons. But in 1887, Mary Ann Rowe's father promised the farm to her younger sister as a marriage dowry. In the spring of 1888, Mary Ann Rowe emigrated to America. She sat down later that year in Dedham, Massachusetts, a small town just outside Boston, and wrote to a close friend back in Dunamagan, recalling young neighbors and loved ones at home.
October 29th, 1888. My dear friend, I dreamed last night that little John was dying. I fancied I was looking at him and had the pleasure of kissing him before he died. I hope and trust nothing is the matter with any of them. I do feel so bad when I go to write home. I would never leave poor Dunamagan if I only thought I would be so homesick. I cannot banish the thought of home out of my mind. Oh, when I look back to our former days, how often we spent an afternoon on Sunday chatting over something funny. And when I think of poor little Ellen and Jeannie and how they used to come out in the fields to where we used to be working. And poor little Mary Ann and how she used to call John, John, John. How nice we used to put in the Sunday together with the little ones around us.
We might infer from such sad dreams of Ireland that Irish women like Mary Ann Rowe could never find happiness in America. But many of them did. Irish immigrant women worked in industry or in service areas catering to the expanding middle class. When Mary Ann Rowe came to America, she found work in the most popular occupation for young Irish women, as a domestic servant.
My dear friend, I am living with a very nice family here in Dedham, Massachusetts. They are very nice people, but they are not Catholics. Their name is Collins. It is an Irish name. I don't know, but they are Irish, but they don't like to say that they're Irish. I'm within 2 or 3 minutes' walk from the church, and there's a splendid church here in Dedham, and 3 priests. I can go to Mass every Sunday and to confession whenever I want to go. Dedham is a very nice place, and it is a country-looking place. And when you look around, there's nothing but trees. I saw an orange tree in the greenhouse. It was placed in a box, and there were 5 oranges growing on it. I must draw to a close for the present by sending ye all my best love. I remain your affectionate friend, Mary Ann Rowe, until death.
Although we may think of it as a low-status job, domestic service provided Irish women with a place to live, with food and clothing, and with money.
It was probably the one job in 19th century America that a woman could occupy that allowed her to save money. Okay, women who were mill hands, women who worked in factories, if they could even make ends meet, was questionable. Okay, whereas these women were able to save money, and they sent vast amounts of money back to Ireland. They also used the money to support Catholic charities and Catholic institutions, churches in the United States. And in one sort of church history after another, it will be, you know, the homage to a servant girl who paid for the stained glass windows or for the baptismal font. There also seems to be pretty good indication that the women who worked in service spent money on themselves. And Charles Dickens, in one of his visits to the United States, he commented, in fact, to see servant girls, and he identified them as Irish, coming out of the basement on a Sunday morning, dressed in the absolutely newest and richest fashion, and his comment was on how everything matched. Now, what we can derive from this is that, on some level, these were women who had a sense of self-worth.
Mary Ann Rowe worked for 9 years as a domestic servant for the Collins family, until on February 28, 1897, she became the wife of Patrick J. Sutton of Providence, Rhode Island. 1 year later, she gave birth to a baby boy, James Rowe Sutton. Mary Ann Rowe's immigration to America had given her opportunities that were unavailable to most women who stayed in Ireland. For example, take the letter written by another young immigrant named Mary Brown to her girlfriend still in Ireland.
Dear Mary, I am very sorry that the priest put such a hard penance on you. You will have to come to the country where there's love and liberty. It agrees very well with me. You would not think I have any beaux, but I have a good many. I got 6 now. I've become quite a Yankee, and if I was at home, the boys would all be around me. I believe I have got no more to say. From your affectionate friend, Mary.
In Ireland, and especially in the late 19th and early 20th century, the Catholic Church was, in a sense, the guardian of the sexual morality of the Irish people. And what I think Mary Brown is referring to is that if you want to escape that kind of repressive clerical and social and parental authority, if you want to be a free agent economically, if you want to be a free agent in terms of marrying whom you choose, your best bet is to come to America.
Londonderry, Ireland, July 24th, 1870. Dear brother, I have sorry news for you. On Thursday morning last, Anne, my eldest child, left here unknown to her mother and all, took all the money she could, leaving not the price of a loaf in the house, and started by steamer for Philadelphia. She is a smart, good girl. Whatever put this into her head? Alexander Sproul.
The Irish newspapers ran columns of missing people. And it was very interesting how often it was that women were the missing partners rather than men. And I sort of contrast this with a column that used to appear in one of the Yiddish newspapers, which was called The Gallery of Missing Men. That is, there were never missing women. It was the men who were somehow off at loose ends. And this, I think, is a kind of interesting sort of contrast that in the Irish press, women were just as likely to be off seeking a life as men were. James Farrell, the author of Studs Lonergan, described his mother and his aunt, who had both come to the United States, as domestic servants that came together. He described them as undaunted and unafraid. And I think that really captures what they were like. And it may be that they were undaunted and unafraid because they came from and created for themselves a culture which was highly autonomous for women.
The westernmost point in Ireland, the closest to America, is in County Kerry at the tip of the Dingle Peninsula. If you stand here and look west, you'll see a cluster of islands. One of them, Inis Duisgart, is sometimes called the Dead Man for its singular silhouette. Only a few hundred feet from the tip of the peninsula is a little hamlet called Gortadhu. Here, in the spring of 1902, lived a young man named Tom Brick. In the early 20th century, Tom Brick was like many people in the West. They still spoke the Irish language and spoke very little English at all.
Tareshvek snov, the Liam Shear Erin Vruok Harna Karagaduva. After bathing, I would lay on the bank over the black rocks adjacent to the sandy beach at Coultrague and look west towards Inis Tushgart. Fishing on Smerwick Harbour was not getting any better and just as dangerous as ever. And receiving an occasional letter from my sister Mary Brick in Salix, Iowa, I was thinking about coming to America.
Despite the yearning and the imagining, to go to another place, to experience another place, there was a profound attachment of the people to their localities. The landscape was full of Gaelic names that were 1,000 years old, that told of the mythology and the literature and the hero deeds that were still talked about at the firesides in the evening. The musical tradition was something that was vibrant among the people. Everybody played some instrument, as it were, or sang, or had something that they could perform, some recitation.
Tar lum o'sheen gotir na nog a der niv kienor. Vi an oha o'sheen, ak vi an brown fin. Mar vi isige na vekakshe a vakarish. Suas la hoshin tiv hir de niv, an gopal bon, agus near fada garef shiadik tashtir trasna na faranya gatir na log.
Throughout the middle decades of the 19th century, the forces of change had transformed the east of Ireland. In the last decades of the century, those forces finally came, rapidly and dramatically, to the west. Tom Brick left Gortadhu on April 15th, 1902. The night before, he was honored with a unique ritual called an American Wake.
What Irish Catholics did is they adapted the traditional wake for the dead to the leave-taking ceremony for an Irish emigrant.
Irish wakes were occasions where there was a lot of festivity, a lot of drinking, a lot of eating, a lot of storytelling, a lot of music and a lot of dancing. People thought this was very odd and very irreverent, but it was the community's way of dealing with grief. There were professional mourners, women who made a living from mourning, and they would come to somebody's house and they would sing high-pitched laments in Irish, a lot of syllables like O'Con, alas, O'Con, 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 alas, alas, alas. And it would generate an incredible amount of emotion, which would release a lot of grief. And Tom Byrne, who's a flute player from Sligo, when he told me about the American wakes that he used to be at as a young boy, and there was a tune, for instance, that would always be played, a lively tune that went, it was called the Farewell Reel, and it went down diddly dum dattle doodle diddly doodle laddy doodle daddy down daddy doodle laddy doodle laddy dum dattle daddle diddly doodle daddle dum. It's a single reel, play 8 bars, play the second 8 bars. And he said in the American wake, that was the last tune they played before the person was escorted down to travel to the port. And he said then they'd play it slow and they'd play it double. So it would go, dum dumble dowdy dumble dowden daddy dumble daddy dowdle lumdy dum daddy dumble daddle lumble plum. And suddenly a lively tune became a lonesome tune. It was that transformation of meaning, which was the essence of the American wake.
The evening of the 14th, there was a farewell party at the Albrick family household. There was singing and dancing, some drink, and lots to eat, such as we had. The large flagstone in front of the fireplace hearth took a terrific beating that evening, while Shawneen played The Wind That Shook the Barley on his fiddle for the 8-hand reel for the 4 boys and 4 girls dancing it. The party remained late that night, and it was little or no sleep that night until breakfast time the next morning and time to make the rounds of the village to say goodbye. There was some weeping and wailing there at the station by the parents, relatives and friends of the emigrant boys and girls boarding the train that day for America. A couple of shrill whistles from the donkey steam locomotive and we were off.
And so, the old people of Gordadoo mourned for young Tom Brick, there being little difference in their minds between going to America and going to the grave. Of course, they could not have been more wrong. America was alive with Irish men and women, even on the prairies of the West. Tom Brick's sister helped him find work near Salix, Iowa, on a threshing gang run by Long Mike O'Connor. A cousin later helped him to find work in the stockyards in Sioux City. And another cousin got him a job mining ore in Butte, Montana, which had the highest percentage of Irish-born population of any city in America. But for most of his first 15 years in the United States, Tom Brick worked in a small Irish-American farming community in the southeastern corner of South Dakota called Gary Owen.
The Irish neighbors included the Clearys, the Murrays, the Malloys, the O'Farrells, and the Mulvilles. Then there was the Manley family, who built a great new barn and to whose house I was invited to attend a party. How they found out I could step dance, I do not know, but when Tom Manley started playing the violin, I could not resist. First on the list was the sailor's hornpipe. And then with me doing the sword dance and others to the tune of the Rocky Road to Dublin, hunt there and turn down the Rocky Road and all the way to Dublin, back for Aldira. I enjoyed the party very much, especially with the Father M. Manley, who spoke fluent Galway Gaelic.
The story of Tom Brick's adaptation to American life is, in many ways, typical. Increasingly, he spoke English instead of his native Irish. And in 1914, he moved from the country to the small town of Vermilion, South Dakota. In 1917, Tom Brick married and started a family with Bridget Cavanaugh, a young Irish-speaking woman who had grown up just a few miles from his home in Gortadoo. Large numbers of immigrants worked their way up from shanty Irish to lace curtain Irish, as did the Bricks, who bought a confectionery business in this building on Vermilion's Main Street. With the end of Prohibition, the little ice cream parlor became a thriving tavern and liquor store. And by the 1940s, Tom and Bridget were able to retire comfortably on the income from several real estate holdings.
Coming into the highly active America of the 1890s or the early 20th century, Irish people had some resources. They had their own self-confidence and the experience that hundreds of thousands of fellow Irish people had come into this society before them. They very frequently had relatives in this country. There was a huge Irish network existing in the United States. It reached all the way down to landladies who kept an eye on emigrant daughters and sons, kept them from drinking, kept them out of trouble, and it reached into high places as well.
Now the Kellys run the state house and the Kellys run the banks. The police and fire department, sure, the Kellys fill the ranks. Dan Kelly runs the railroads, John Kelly runs the seas. Kate Kelly runs the suffragettes and she looks right good to me. Well, I went and asked directions from a naturalized Chinese. But he said, please excuse me, but me name it is Kelly. And there's Kelly from Dublin, Kelly from Sligo, little Mickey Kelly who came from the County Clare. Sure, Kelly built the pyramids with good old Galway granite, and when Kelly discovered the North Pole, sure he found Pat Kelly there.
Throughout his retirement, Tom Brick remained a faithful Irish Catholic who worshipped at St. Agnes Church in Vermilion. He remained a loyal Irish Democrat who voted for George McGovern in 1972. And he continued to speak Irish with his older immigrant friends and to play the old jigs and reels on fiddles he made himself. Although wrenched from the intensely traditional West of Ireland, Tom Brick had adapted successfully to life in modern America. When he died in 1979, there were 5 million people in Ireland. But there were more than 40 million people of Irish ancestry in America.
Dear brother and sister, in this place about 10 years ago there was no church nor no priest. But we have our new church finished. Now we have Mass every Sunday and we can mind our duty as well here as we can do in Ireland. Your brother to death, Arthur Quinn.
The arrival of the Irish in the 19th century transformed the Catholic Church in America, which till then had been small and largely invisible. It became not only a place of worship, but of education, recreation, business, and social life. And it became a bulwark against the animosity of native-born Americans, providing comfort and protection for the Irish immigrants, even as it worked to enhance their status in American life. In the 20th century, when millions of other European and Latin American Catholics came to America, they joined a church dominated by the Irish. By the 1930s, the Irish accounted for a minority of the Catholics, but a large majority of the bishops, priests, and nuns. Indeed, the influence of the church was so great both in America and Ireland that it obscured the more ancient roots of Irish religious belief. Despite the statues of Catholic saints, belief in the healing power of holy wells, such as this one, called St. Bridget's Well, was part of a whole system of traditional beliefs and customs. They had existed for centuries before St. Patrick brought Christianity to Ireland and flourished long afterwards. Even into the 20th century, some Irish still prayed at holy wells, practiced harvest rituals, enjoyed traditional crossroads dancing, and displayed hex signs to ward off fairies.
For the most part, they believed that the fairies were malevolent, or potentially so. One of the worst things that fairies supposedly could do would be that they would steal healthy babies out of the parents' cribs, and that the fairies especially like to steal young male children, and consequently the sex of the male children was disguised by their wearing petticoats in order to trick the fairies. And so this was one way by which, you know, Irish country people could explain the high levels of infant mortality amongst them.
Well, the fairies are really, they're trivialized now in popular culture. These quaint little people, you know, after Walt Disney had his way with the fairies, I think nothing was ever the same again as far as their popular image is concerned. But the belief in the fairies is of long standing in Ireland, and it's one aspect of belief in a whole other world than the world of conventional Western Christianity.
But Catholicism was extremely important, even if these people were non-practicing, or even if their Catholicism was a barely Christianized paganism. It was because of their Catholicism that their lands had been confiscated, that they had been excluded from political authority and economic opportunities for so long, because it was a major, and eventually became the major, the central part of their personal and their communal identity.
In the second half of the 19th century, the Irish Catholic Church was transformed. As if chastised by the Great Famine, the Irish people paid increasing devotion to a more authoritarian church. Crossroads dancing and harvest rituals gave way to a rigid code of sexual conduct and an intense devotion to the Blessed Virgin Mary. When these devoted Irish Catholics sailed out of Queenstown, the principal point of embarkation for emigrants going to America, the last thing they would see were the spires of St. Colman's Cathedral, reminding them, it was said, of their obligations to Holy Mother Church in the New World. In the south of Ireland, in County Cork, near the small town of Calais, is a beautiful area called Glenbower Woods. Here, a young lad named Thaig O'Kiachoin, or Timothy Cashman, spent the best days of his youth.
Sunday afternoons in summertime, the boys and girls congregated at a crossroads in the district and danced away the time until sundown. A piper came there from some distance to provide the music, also a violin player. This indeed was the simple life of the country people, but emigration was exacting a heavy toll.
In the spring of 1892, Timothy Cashman boarded a train at this station in Calais and, like so many others before and since, left his home in Ireland. Timothy Cashman came to Boston, where he took a job as a laborer for the Boston Belting Company, bought a home in the Roxbury neighborhood, and started a family with his Irish-American wife, Mary. Also, Cashman joined several Irish ethnic organizations, including nationalist groups that supported the cause of Irish freedom from Great Britain. The struggle that had begun with the United Irishmen and the County Wexford Rebellion of 1798 had been revived repeatedly over the century.
by Daniel O'Connell's Catholic emancipation movement in the 1820s, by the young Irelanders in the 1840s, by the Fenians in the 1860s, and by the Irish Land League in the 1880s. The Fenians in America raised an armed force of Civil War veterans and launched an invasion of British Canada. And they pledged to return and fight for freedom in Ireland, where they would exact revenge for the old wounds of the famine era.
Let us hope that before long we shall see a new Ireland, which shall be a nation, who to us is our mother Erin, stretching forth the proud hands of motherhood to her exiled sons and daughters, and calling them back to her.
The day after Easter Sunday, 1916, a small band of radical Irish nationalists initiated military action. They seized control of the General Post Office and several other buildings in Dublin. By the time they surrendered 1 week later, over 400 rebels, soldiers, and civilians had been killed. At first, the rebel leaders did not have wide support among the Irish people, but their execution by a British firing squad galvanized the Irish will for freedom in Ireland and in Irish America. Michael Collins, the new military leader of the rebels, welded the remnants of the Easter rebels into a new and more deadly fighting force, the Irish Republican Army, and led the IRA in a series of guerrilla raids. But the key to Irish victory lay not in Ireland, but in America. The political leader of the rebels was an American-born Irishman named Eamon de Valera. In 1919, de Valera came to America, where he enlisted over 800,000 Irish Americans and raised over $10 million in support of the struggle for an independent Ireland. With that financial aid, the IRA continued to fight their war of independence and eventually forced the British to the bargaining table. The resulting Treaty of December 1921 called for a partition of the island, with six counties in the north remaining part of Great Britain. With a Protestant majority, but a large, dissatisfied Catholic minority, Northern Ireland was destined to be a source of political troubles in the future. Still, after centuries of struggle against British rule, most of Ireland was free. Across the Atlantic, Irish Americans like Timothy Cashman also celebrated. In a sense, they too were finally free. Free to turn their attention from the long-standing problems of Ireland towards the expanding opportunities of America. Many of the ships that carried the immigrants of the old world to the new were built in Belfast, in the northern county of Antrim. Modern steamships made the crossing from Ireland to America faster and safer, and they made it easier to return. That made the decision to go much less difficult for young Irish emigrants of the 20th century. Living in Belfast in 1920 was an 18-year-old Catholic boy named James Quinn. Deeply devoted to his mother, but apparently in conflict with a heavy drinking father, he ran away from home and emigrated to America. Possibly because he entered the United States illegally, James Quinn changed his name to Tim O'Brien. But under that pseudonym, he sent a steady stream of postcards and letters home to his mother in Ireland.
January 1921, New York. No one here shines his own shoes, but has it done every day for 10 cents in a shine parlor? We eat in automatic cafes. You put in a nickel or a dime and pull out your favorite dinner from a machine. or sit in a high stool at a lunch counter and have a hash slinger shoot at you. I'm starting for South America tomorrow. November 1921, Para, Brazil. Traveled with the Jivaro headhunters unharmed. Someday I'll write out the whole works and put it in a magazine. December 1921, on board train, Mississippi. Dear Mother, there was no difficulty for yours truly when it came to getting ashore sans passport with my curios from the headhunter country and devil, my pet monkey. This morning I left New Orleans, my fare paid for by the museum people to whom I have loaned my Indian collections. The newspaper tell me I can easily clear $500 on the first story and a few thousand after that in the book form. You're going to have a son you can be proud of, Mommy. October 1922, Los Angeles. Holdups and murders are more numerous here than in any town in the Union. But I can't kick, I like a town full of life. I'm hitting on all six. I've got a new sweet mama. She shakes shimmy on Cleopatra scenes over to Ingram's. A perfect blonde, hot dogs.
America is change. Immigration is one of the great modern dramas of change. So in order to understand the novelty of America, in order to understand the impulse and the momentum that have made America a society of change, we must understand that the people who came here were ready for change.
May 1923, Los Angeles. Dearest Mother, God, I never knew I was alive till I got out here and woke up. Money is a wonderful key to happiness. California is going to be my home, Mama, and I wish you could decide to come out and live with me. At present, I'm doing well selling, but I lack capital. Do you know anyone who wants in on the ground floor of a 20,000 barrel a day proposition? No, it's not oil. It's virgins. The Blessed Mother sells better than popcorn to the Latin element in California. April 6th, 1924, Dearest Mother, my curios, shrunken heads, etc., have been released from the LA Museum and I've started my own roadshow. We had our world premiere some time ago and left Los Angeles to tour US. Maybe we'll go as far as your country. I gotta beat it round to the dump, get my megaphone and startle creation with my head shrinkers of the Amazon. There's a line of guys, a two bits apiece, waiting to see Captain O'Brien, the explorer. So I'll say adios. Tim.
On May 20th, 1924, at the Long Beach Pier, Los Angeles Detective Lieutenants Bartley and Shamo pricked up their ears when they heard Tim O'Brien inviting spectators to see the only shrunken human heads in captivity. Several months earlier, a valuable collection of shrunken heads had been stolen from a Los Angeles anthropologist. Although it is possible that O'Brien was exhibiting his own collection of shrunken heads, he was found guilty of first-degree burglary. The judge agreed that he was eligible to be released on bail pending an appeal, but Tim O'Brien never showed up in court again.
September 22nd, 1924. Havana, Cuba. Darling Mother, just taking a trip east to New York on the Venezuela for a rest. We've been 3 weeks afloat, calling at many Central American ports. With the help of God and the White Star Line, we'll soon be together again. Tim.
This was the last letter Tim O'Brien's mother received from her son. The records of the Venezuela do not show him disembarking in Havana, nor do they show him arriving in New York. Tim O'Brien seems to have vanished without a trace. 60 years earlier, the New York politician Richard O'Gorman had written, "The destiny of our race is to me utterly mysterious. The moment it touches this soil, it seems to be imbued with miraculous energy for good and evil."
So much mental and physical vigor, elasticity and adaptability must have a destiny to fulfill. Century, Irish Americans were still often stereotyped as working class buffoons. But the reality was quite different. By the 1920s, the Irish had arrived economically. 35% of all Irish Americans held white-collar jobs, 50% were skilled laborers, and only 15% were unskilled. More importantly, these percentages were the same as those for all Americans. Since the Great Migration of the Famine Era, a number of social escalators had lifted the Irish into economic security, including the Democratic Party and the Catholic Church. And the rise of labor unions was transforming Irish industrial workers into members of the middle class. Of course, another factor was that most of these successful Irish were not immigrants themselves, but were the children of Irish immigrants. Ethnic organizations, such as the Ancient Order of Hibernians, the Catholic Total Abstinence Union, and the various county societies, contributed to Irish American economic success and to their cultural adaptation.
I found a four-leaf shamrock one day, soon she was in my arms. Now I know the reason to say shamrocks are lucky charms.
For the most part, they danced the waltz or the foxtrot. But many could also perform the old traditional dances they had learned from their immigrant parents and grandparents. Even after World War II, there were still many distinctively Irish-American communities and personalities.
There's a typical Tipperary, a typical Dublin Bay, well, a typical County Kerry in the good old USA. Although you're many miles from where the shamrock rolls, you'll find an Irishman no matter where you go. They've got Irish on the screen, even the money here is green. Cardinal Gibbons, he runs the show, and George Meany, he helps us to get all the dough. John McCormack's an Irish star, Henry Ford makes all the cars. Dempsey and Sullivan are the thing, for they are the champions of the ring. There's Scott Fitzgerald and Flann O'Connor and New York's Alfred D. Mayor Curley and Mayor Daly, Joe McCarthy and Eugene O'Neill. There's Keaton and Kelly and Kelly and Hart and Mother Jones Abu. George M. Cohen and there's Spencer Tracy too. Jimmy Cagney and Bing Crosby, the Kennedy brothers too. And they're Irish through and through. If you want an Irish treat, you'll march up and down Delancey Street. You'll think that you were home in Ireland.
All of his cousins, whom he reckons by the dozens, welcome the return of a man they consider a native son. President Kennedy takes tea with the clan at the farmhouse where his paternal great-grandfather was born. Mr. Kennedy noted that he was glad to see a few cousins who didn't catch the boat.
It's impossible to understand people unless we understand their origins. So that the imprint of Ireland on Irish people made them behave in a certain way. Their children, their grandchildren, their great-grandchildren have also parts of that imprint.
I always believe, you see, that the Irish, that this is one of his Celtic inheritances, that I have a tail. You can't see it. It's really more of a flourish than a tail, and sometimes it emerges in my signature. But it is a tail. There's no question about it. It is the flourish of the Celt, and it's much more powerful than a physical tail. And it's the exclusive, property of the Irish, this particular tale, because it's our cultural extension. And without this, I don't think we would have survived abroad.
At first, Irish society appears to be much simpler, much more traditional, much more pastoral than American society. And so, in a sense, it does appear as if it's a return to some sort of idyllic, innocent childhood. After a while, you begin to realize that Irish society is every bit as complex and has at least as many problems as American society, but at first it appears to be so different, so old-fashioned in a number of ways, that it has an enormous sort of nostalgic appeal.
We have a saying in Ireland at the moment that nostalgia is the thing of the future. And then people say nostalgia is not what it used to be, you know. And, we're very, very familiar with the concept of nostalgia. It's all pervasive.
The 200-year history of Irish Catholic emigration to America is dominated by the image of the immigrant as exile. The great, long-standing dream for many of those exiles was to someday return to Holy Mother Ireland. Among their number was the Irish-speaking immigrant from County Cork, Timothy Cashman. In 1925, in the wake of Irish freedom from Britain, Timothy Cashman retired from his job in Boston and bought passage on a steamship back to Ireland. The Irish port had been named Queenstown by the British after Queen Victoria. Now, 33 years after Cashman's departure, it had been rechristened with its ancient Irish name of Cove by the newly formed government of Independent Ireland.
Sunday, July 19th. Here I am on board the steamship Laconia from Boston, bound for Cove, Ireland, after months of hesitation. After 33 years, I am gladdened at this moment more than I can express in words or writing with the thought of seeing dear old Erin once more. I put my foot on shore at the customs in the morning at 4 a.m. My heart sank as I saw the street at that early hour without a soul abroad, and in looking out at the harbor, overhung with dark lowering clouds, it presented a scene of desolation. However, I got to Killa before 11 o'clock, and 'twas rainy and cold, mud and dirt all over everything. You'd imagine the houses were built before Abraham's time, ancient looking, without life. Walking over the mud-covered little street, everything looked so curious to me, familiar, yet not familiar. I can't get my eyes to see things as they were to me before I left. I have visited the remains of the old home. Standing there in the floor, which is now grass-grown, what memories came to me. I stood there for 15 minutes in sad contemplation, thinking of the times when the family lived together, father, mother, sister, and brothers. The tears came to my eyes. Cattle grazing around, looking curiously towards me, as if they'd asked the question, "What are you doing here?" Signed, T. Cashman.
Well, he discovers, as those most of those few immigrants who did try to return discovers, that that there really is nothing left in Ireland for him. Most of his relations have died or emigrated. The village in which she lived has half or less of the population that it did before. The home in which she had been born has disintegrated or been turned into a cow shed. And consequently, he's deeply and bitterly disappointed.
Among Italian immigrants to America, over 40% returned to live in their homeland. Among Poles and Hungarians, over 50% returned. And among Greek immigrants, over 60% returned. But less than 10% of all Irish immigrants to America returned to live in Ireland. This, despite the Irish perception of the immigrant as exile.
The nationalist politicians had always promised that if Ireland were free, emigration would stop because there would be prosperity and employment for all those at home. But the reality was quite otherwise. There were very high levels of Irish emigration in the 1920s, high levels of Irish emigration primarily to Britain in the late 1940s and in the 1950s. And so tens of thousands of young people were still forced or encouraged to go abroad.
In the 1960s and the 1970s, an expanding economy stemmed the flow out of Ireland. But in the 1980s, the economy soured again, sending a new wave of immigrants, many of them illegal, to the United States. In the 1990s, Ireland's most valuable export continues to be her own people.
In a sense, we're all exiles in that society changes so rapidly for the last several hundred years that it's very difficult for us to deal with the reality of change using the ideas and concepts and rhetoric of the past. And so we find ourselves in a sort of exile. And what the Irish experienced, moving from the countryside to cities which happen to be in America or in England or in Australia or in Canada, is not that dissimilar from the experience which so many of us still have today, constantly uprooted, constantly searching for the perfect job or the perfect house, whether it's in a suburb farther out of town or whether it's in a newer city with a more dynamic economy. And yet, like the Irish immigrants, we all, or most of us, yearn nostalgically for some sort of fancied security that we had as children. And so, like F. Scott Fitzgerald, an Irish American, put it, we run faster and faster, hoping someday to catch up with a past which we have irretrievably lost.
Timothy Cashman spent only a few weeks revisiting the haunts of his youth. But before he left, he walked again in Glenbower Woods, the place that was, for him, the embodiment of Mother Ireland. There, in the stone of the old bridge, Timothy Cashman carved his name in Gaelic script. Then he left and came home. Home to America.
This program was made possible by a grant from the National Endowment for the Humanities.